In this series, I'm uncovering the history of the ordinary British home.
I want to explore the homes that most of us live in and that most of us take for granted. From Tudor cottages and Victorian terraces to post-war high-rise flats, I want to reveal how these often ordinary-looking homes are, in fact, extraordinary.
Paul!
In each episode, I'll search out the stories of how and why our homes were built, and I'll explore the evidence of centuries of design and redesign.
Since I've got you here and I can explore your plumbing in detail, our homes offer an intimate portrait of our public and our private selves. From the glass in our windows to the gadgets in our kitchens, they lay bare how healthy, how wealthy, even how happy we are.
Cheeks the balls.
We have lots in common. I'm always kissing architecture. She loves a terraced house.
I'll uncover the architectural details which have shaped our social history and transformed our daily lives.
I want to go beyond masonry and mortar and come face to face with residents, past and present. I want to understand how they lived and how they transformed buildings into homes. The cottage is the dream home most of us aspire to. Yet behind its seemingly timeless facade lurks an event for history, because the cottage was the scene of our most dramatic domestic revolution.
Stoneleigh in Warwickshire lies in the heart of England, on the edge of the ancient Forest of Arden. The village can trace its history back at least as far as the Domesday Book. In 1086, it was home to 68 villagers, 4 smallholders, 2 slaves, and 2 priests. Through the story of the cottages in this archetypal English village, I want to tell the story of our nation's cottages. What's drawn me to Stoneleigh are its wonderful historical records, which reveal every last detail of villagers' lives over 5 centuries. By sifting through the documents and by exploring Stoneleigh's remarkable collection of timber-framed cottages, I want to piece together the reality of life in these homes.
This map of Stoneleigh Village dates from 1597. It's a remarkable and indeed beautiful document. It allows me to step back in time. I can see this location then, the village green, where I'm standing, and there are the almshouses which survive over there. They were new when the map was made. They're dated 1594. There were 45 houses in the village in 1597, and remarkably, a third of those still survive. This one in front of me on the corner was occupied by Thomas Messenger. He can tell a few things from his home. It is small, of course, charming, picturesque, but very small. And behind it, there's only a fifth of an acre, a small garden, really. So we can conclude from his home that he must have been a man of very humble means. The map tells us that in 1597, this house was occupied by Elizabeth Jenkin. Now, to judge by the size of her house, she's a little bit better off than her neighbour, Thomas Messenger, and she had half an acre of land to the rear, but the house is still relatively humble. And that's the extraordinary thing about Stoneleigh, the survival of such a large number of early, ordinary cottages. Tudor palaces, manor houses, and merchant houses tell all about lives of the rich and powerful. These tell us how the other half lived. Some of the village's oldest surviving cottages were built long before this map was made. Skep Cottage is one of Stoneleigh's most ancient. It dates back to the middle of the 15th century. When Thomas Messenger lived here,
He almost certainly farmed the land. Today it's home to Ian, who works in renewable energy, and his wife Marilyn. I'm on the hunt for clues about how their cottage evolved from the simplest shelter into a home we all recognise today.
Ooh, tight squeeze. Gosh, what a wonderful little hairy world I'm in. Thatch.
Oh, fascinating. Ow. My excitement, I'm going to tumble down, but this is amazing. Oh, well, this is good. This is very good. This is excellent. Soot blackening. It almost comes off in my hand. Soot. Dark. Stay. Why this is so exciting is that it's conclusive evidence this space I'm in now was once part of an open hall. A hall open from the ground floor, gloaming, into the roof space here. One volume. Like every modest medieval home, Skep Cottage had no upper story. The stairs and first floor rooms were improvements that weren't made for at least another 100 years. Originally, this house was little more than a roof over its inhabitants' heads. It had just two rooms, a chamber for sleeping, which was probably unheated, and a hall, the main living space, at the centre of which was an open hearth. Smoke from this fire drifted up to the roof timbers above.
Incredible, this, isn't it? It's so intriguing. Over there, one would expect on some of those timbers to see hooks or nails from which hunks of meat would have been dangled, curing in the smoke of the fire. Hanging here would have preserved the meat itself from vermin running all around. Such tremendously stark contrast with the world below. Here is a kind of memory of once a rough and ready life, living in a smoky room beneath this thatch. And now, of course, when I exit through this hatch, I leave the medieval world back to the modern world. That's it, by contrast. It's clean, tidy, neat, hygienic. I know which I prefer, but never mind, I have to go back now. Oops.
The open hall was the centrepiece of almost all medieval homes. From the smallest cottages to the most imposing castles.
Even in a tiny cottage like this, the hall would have been an evocation in miniature of the great hall of a castle, of a grand manor house. And this double height space, as it was originally, would have had an inherent grandeur about it, I suppose. You imagine sitting here with a view up into the roof timbers, would have felt big. The chair here, probably the only one in the hall, was reserved for the use, the sole use, of the head of the household. The family sitting around would no doubt be seated on more uncomfortable benches. So this chair, when occupied by the head of the household, was like the throne occupied by the lord of the manor in his great hall. Yes, I feel the power.
For most medieval cottages, the basic design, a timber frame, usually filled with wattle and daub, and topped with a thatched roof, scarcely changed from the time of the Norman conquest. So for centuries, one of the most highly prized building materials remained the same: wood. Stoneleigh's cottages were built with timber taken from the nearby Forest of Arden, an ancient woodland dating back to the end of the last ice age.
We're in the Forest of Arden. It has a wonderful, isn't it, romantic ring to it. This is Shakespeare's forest, because it goes right up, doesn't it, to Stratford-upon-Avon.
Yeah, if you think of Warwickshire, it's sort of split into two halves by the River Avon, which kind of runs diagonally through the county. The area north and west of the Avon was dominated by the Forest of Arden.
Right.
Hundreds of square miles.
It is, of course, incredible. This is the landscape, the woodscape, I suppose I should say, that the medieval occupiers of Stoneleigh would have known.
This is about as close as you can get in Warwickshire to a typical bit of managed woodland in medieval times.
Yeah. I mean, tell me about the sort of trees that would have been grown.
Right, well, what we have here is we have coppice with standards.
Standards yeah. are the big trees.
They're the big trees. It could be allowed to grow for 150 years or so for you know, building timber.
And this is a Bloomley, the standard.
This is a standard, yeah.
So again, just thinking back, so the estate owner who owns a tree, or indeed a carpenter who is involved in house construction, would have stood here and he looked at this particular tree and said, that's a good one. That's of an age, or in a shape to use.
Everything would have been scheduled. Yeah. Everything would have been scheduled, and sometimes you might have to wait a long time for the bit of wood that you need.
Yeah.
I mean, it would have controlled the number of timber frame cottages that could be built at any one time.
So the ancient wildwood of popular imagination was far from wild, really, wasn't it? It was controlled and managed.
Very much so, yeah. I mean, every wood had a boundary by the medieval times, and you could get into a lot of trouble if you sneaked into wood and took wood out without permission.
Chopping down a standard without permission would land you with a hefty fine. But villagers did have the right to coppice smaller trees from their local wood, taking branches for firewood and house repairs.
Poor defensive little ones. I pick on the small guys. Now, that's the handy pieces that I can use in my cottage in Stoneleigh for repairing the outhouse. Oh.
You can begin to understand why medieval woodland was so carefully managed and so strictly guarded. The demand for wood must have been insatiable. Used for heating the home, for cooking food, for making charcoal, for doing sort of small repairs to the home, and to build even a three-room house needed 110 trees. Stoneleigh's oldest cottages were built using an ingenious method of construction. Ah, here is a pair of the main structural load-bearing timbers used in the construction of this cottage. You can see they are wonderfully wobbly and, of course, set on the diagonal. They are, however, made of very solid oak. These are called cruck blades, this one and that one. And cruck constructions, typical of the medieval cottages of Stoneleigh. Now, although wobbly, the cruck blades are wobbly in a very symmetrical manner because each is cut from the same tree trunk. This was a very simple but strong form of construction.
The cruck blades were joined at the apex and tied together by a collar beam, creating a simple tent-like frame. In small cottages, each pair of crucks usually defined the boundary of a different room. So to build the average three-room cottage required four sets of cruck blades. Crucks were the dominant form of medieval construction in the Midlands and the west of England, and were also found in Wales and Scotland. Throughout Britain, over 4,000 of these cruck frames are still standing. The Oak Frame Training Forum near Bristol teaches traditional cruck carpentry.
I'm actually making square pegs at the moment, and we call them billets. And I'm just splitting them up out of solid, well, quite wet green oak.
Right. It looks frightfully easy what you're doing, and if I ask to have a go, I'll reveal how difficult it is. But, I mean, I wouldn't mind having it.
It is incredibly easy.
I presume one cuts with the grain as far as possible.
Try to keep the volumes the same on either side, so always break in half. So if you're safe, go for there. That's a good point there.
OK. How many fingers do you still have? OK. What's that now? Isn't it? Yeah.
Lovely.
Yeah. Okay, and so that's our basic building component in a sense.
Yep, so the next thing is to put them onto a shave horse. Oh. I usually put the big end underneath here and use your feet to hold the tip.
Oh, yes, okay.
Yeah, so you can see there, that peg is a finished peg, and that's going to take 1.5 tonnes of shear.
Right.
So in a joint, it's incredibly strong.
Again, you make it look very easy, but obviously, for one thing, is wrist action controlling this tool. And also, you've got to coordinate your hands and your feet.
Yeah.
Big deal. So I cut myself in half at this point, I see. Yeah, it's a good reminder of just how skilled it was in the past to make a timber-framed house. A farmer couldn't just go into the forest, you know, cut down an oak tree and make a barn. He needed carpenters, guys who were professional.
It's unlikely that the average farmer would build their own house, and village houses would be built in a yard. The crucial thing in a yard is that you've got a flat surface to work on. Having a nice flat floor is really incredibly useful. It's a nightmare building on a hillside.
Building a timber frame was much like assembling IKEA flat pack furniture. In theory, at least, a simple matter of slotting together all the component parts.
Here we've got the mortise, which is the hole in the crock blade, and what slides into it is this thing, the tenon. This is the classic carpentry joint of the timber framing world.
And here we see one of the other great characteristics of timber frame construction, the carpenter's mark. Look there, number two, showing these two timbers are meant to, well, they go together.
That's right. It's quite important when you have a complex frame that everything's numbered because it's been prefabricated off-site.
Yes.
And when it's transported, you won't know where anything goes unless there's a number.
Well, let's have a go, see how heavy this is. I mean, it's a bit of oak, not very long, this collar, but it's thick. See it? Ooh. No. This is a team effort.
Yeah, I think we need to call some people in to help get this together.
Yeah. Okay, well, I'll get back astride my piece of oak. Let me slide it. Oh, God, it is. Oh, okay. You can see how making a timber frame building was a community effort. I understand why we shaped these the way we did. The tapering clearly is part of pulling it together, and the point that helps you to navigate into the hold. Any little... Ah, there we go.
So there's a big mallet, and you can whack those pegs in now.
Traditional activity. OK. OK.
Very nice. That's pulling it together nicely.
Yeah, you can see it. Every hit gets tighter.
Superb.
Nice bit.
Paul!
Well, it's handsome, and it looks strong, but here, of course, the curve becomes the great ornament.
We must have pleased the carpenter and the landowner to actually use up their curvy wood, which normally wouldn't get used.
I suppose they also, you could say they are a reflection of the liking of the Anglo-Saxon world for the curvaceous, the sinuous, the feminine, of course, really. You know, world of the great goddess and all that. The feminine power.
It was something you could show off to your neighbours. And they're usually always invisible places in the halls. They're an aesthetic statement that's quite, bling, a bit of medieval bling.
And also this kind of wonderful, you know, way they express their construction methods. I love these pegs kind of poking right through with their kind of slightly battered and scraggly ends where they've been beaten into the earth.
Yeah, that shouldn't be like that.
No.
But I blame you.
Medieval England was a nation of tenants. From the greatest lord to the lowliest serf, almost everyone paid rent. Aside from God and the king, a medieval landlord was the most powerful figure in a tenant's life. Around a third of the land in medieval England, including the Stoneleigh estate, was owned by monasteries. The abbey at Stoneleigh was founded in 1155 after Henry II granted the estate to the Cistercians, making them landlords of the village.
This splendid space was the abbey's undercroft. Above was a dormitory. And this incredible survival tells us so much about the Cistercians. They believed in a simple, austere monastic life. And that belief is reflected very directly in their architecture, or so simple, austere, powerful, almost abstract. There's no sort of superfluous or imposed decoration, no carved heads, no mouldings. The Cistercians were suspicious of ornamentation, of carving, because they believed that such things could distract monks from the contemplation of the pure wonder of God.
But don't be fooled by the Cistercian spiritual devotion. These monks were also hard-headed landlords, whose control extended to every detail of village life. In Stoneleigh, as in all medieval villages, the lord of the manor held regular manor court sessions where local justice was meted out. Aside from cracking down on breaches of the peace, the monks of Stoneleigh were keen to squeeze a healthy profit from their tenants, as the villages' manor court rolls reveal.
So what can these rolls tell us about day life of tenants in Stoneleigh?
This is a record of 1478. And so what this is telling us is a man called Ralph Winford.
Oh, there he is.
Ralph Winford is taking on a cottage with 6 acres of land. In order to seal the bargain of him becoming a tenant, he has to pay an entry fine.
Oh, I see.
And it's an entry fine in kind, not in cash.
Yeah.
And it's 12 capons.
Capons? Chickens.
Fat hens. That's
fat hens.
That's
12 fat hens, which yes. The monks want to devour, of course. It's very, very... So that's a one-off payment for entry into the agreement. Other things as well?
Well, the other one is the heriot, which is the death duty, which will be an ox or a horse or some valuable animal of that kind.
The woman loses her husband, then she has to also lose her best ox.
Yes.
It's tough. Life is tough.
Yes, right. Yeah, so the ox might be better loved than the husband. Yeah. But what is unusual about this particular record is the detail it goes into on the question of repair and maintenance. It tells us that he's agreed to repair, maintain and sustain the said cottage, and it's said that he will do this at his own expense.
Yeah.
You know, it's his responsibility, he has to pay, and it says that if he fails to do it, then it will be forfeit, and it actually uses the word forfeiture as the penalty if he breaks the terms of the tenant.
On top of paying ground rent, tenants also pay to build their cottages and to repair them. And if they fail to properly maintain the homes they'd invested so much in, they risk losing them to their landlord. Stoneleigh's records show that one poor harvest was sometimes all that separated the house proud from the homeless.
This one here, for example, William Reeve, has ruinous and unrepaired buildings. We're told that he left the vill and, as a pauper, is wandering from village to village seeking alms.
Right,
so he's become a sort of a beggar and vagabond.
Vagabond. This has a desperate quality, doesn't it? I mean, the lives of the four families are desperate. Also, the estate is in some dismay.
People at the time talked about the wheel of fortune and that you could be happy and healthy and wealthy at one stage of your life, and within a very short time, you could find yourself at the bottom in poverty and misery. And this clearly suggests that that really did happen.
For many of Stoneleigh's 15th and 16th century residents, a house was far more than just a home. Alongside regular domestic life, the cottage was often also a workplace, which tenants depended on for their livelihoods. The current owner of Phoenix Cottage is John, a retired financial consultant. His 16th century forebears were John and Elizabeth Jenkins. The pair were brewers, and they turned their home into an informal village pub.
This is very, very exciting. We are doing in this cottage, indeed in this very room, what Mr. and Mrs. Jenkins did here 500 years ago. We are brewing ale.
So we've got hot water, and then we have malted barley. So what we need to do now is we need to take some of our water and add it to our malt to make a mash.
But we know that making sort of humble ale was not below the interest of the law of the land, because the Jenkinses here got into trouble over their ale with the, at the assizes. So there was some, there was some issue about what they were doing.
Yeah, the assizes can control quality. They control, they set the price that you can sell your ale for based on the malt. You have a chap called Ale Connor, or an ale taster, and his job was to go around when people advertised a new brew, and he would sample it, make sure it was up to speed and not ropey, smoky, stale, all right, these.
By drinking it.
By drinking it, as a job I'd
nice
like.
Nice job. So, Mrs. Jenkins made the mash in the morning. After lunch, one can carry on with making the ale. So, what is the next stage?
So, very simply, just separate the two. The last bits of goodness out.
The liquid's gone through.
Yep. And the, most of the sugar should have come out of the barley.
So this is the liquid here.
It's called the wort, and that's what you brew with.
And that's the heart and soul of a good ale, of course.
It is indeed, yes.
So, now, what's the magic ingredient that transforms this wort, you call it, I call it nectar, into good, strong alcohol?
We need balm, yeast, or God's good.
God's good.
Three names for the same thing. Put some in.
Okay, so.
And then it'll start to work.
It's wonderful. And I know it needs to go on fermenting for maybe 4 or 5 days from now, but we can have a quick taste.
Of course you can.
Not to kill me, I'm sure.
A little dip from that one there.
OK, so this in my tummy will turn to alcohol, I suppose, gradually. Cheers. Absolutely delicious, isn't it? Good heavens. Right, so more of that. Join me.
But I will join you in the...
God, you can market that, I tell you.
What should we call it?
Well, you know, Cruickshanks.
It's rather good.
When the brewing process was complete, the Jenkinses would let the villagers know the house was open for business by erecting the ale stake. Here is the ale stake. It's a rather cunning device. Up it goes. The leaves were cut when the ale was ready to drink, so it's possible to judge the age of the ale from the freshness of the leaves. Therefore, seasoned drinkers could tell when it was a good time to pop inside for the perfect pint.
In the multi-purpose hall, all life revolved around the open fire. Working, eating and cooking happened in the same smoky room, where ideas of comfort and privacy were very different to our own. The most intimate details of life in Stoneleigh's cottages are revealed by the villagers' fascinating collection of probate inventories. These were compiled when an individual died, and they list all their worldly goods. They are a unique portrait of some of Stoneleigh's most humble homes.
This is the inventory of John Allett, weaver of Stoneleigh, 1537.
Right. This one, of course, is completely unreadable for me. It's in English, not Latin. No. But, I mean, you, what to say?
It's very phonetically spelt.
Yes, yes.
And in a sort of Midlands dialect.
Oh, my goodness.
So,
right.
But there are bits that are easy for us to read. So it's divided into rooms, and that's the key thing for us. In the hall.
In the hall.
In the chamber. So we can see not only which goods he had, but actually where he had them in the house.
So what does it say in the hall?
A hanging of painted cloths.
There's a value there, presumably.
Yes, eightpence. So not very much.
Okay.
So a small table and two forms.
Okay.
So the forms or benches are on one side of the table, perhaps, and then we've also got here a cupboard and two stools.
I mean, what about cushions? It's not the equivalent of the, you know, the easy chair of the modern home.
There's certainly nothing like that. No, you're not sitting around in here and relaxing and putting your feet up. So you're in here for a particular purpose, and probably that purpose is dining.
So this obviously the more public part of the house, the hall, you know, things to display to the neighbours. Now we're going to the more private parts, the chambers.
Yes, in here, in the chamber. Here we've got the two bedsteads. And then on top of that, we've got one feather bed, so obviously one of them is better furnished than the other one. And we've got two bolsters.
Yeah.
We've got three mattresses. And we've got five pillows. And this is worth much more. We've got 5 shillings.
Oh, I see. OK. This is the notion of the bed and its fittings being the great status symbol, the kind of spot, the sports car image, you know, of furniture. It's a big show-off thing, isn't it, the bed?
I never thought of it quite like that. But it's certainly, yes, it's certainly where all these things, yes, come together. This is a level of, a kind of comfort that's much closer to what we're familiar with. So it's a comfort around sort of cosy, soft furnishings. Yes.
An entire world of these people are documented on these slivers.
Yes, that's right. All his goods go from here to here. And that's a lot of goods. This is not a short list because he has nothing. It just shows us how very important every single thing on this was.
A modern house, of course, my house. I mean, if I wrote all the things, I'd mean, fill this box with junk, yes, I've got, you know.
For almost 400 years, the monks of Stoneleigh had run the village. But between 1532 and 1534, the established order was turned on its head. As Henry VIII broke with the Catholic Church and soon afterwards began the dissolution of the monasteries. Across the country, monastic estates were seized by the crown and tenants, who for generations had owed their rent and their allegiance to the same lord of the manor, found themselves with new masters. For Stoneleigh's villagers, the church's waning power was replaced by the rising influence of trade and commerce. In 1561, Sir Thomas Lee bought the entire estate. He was purchasing not just land, but a new status as lord of the manor. Lee was a fabulously wealthy London merchant. He was Lord Mayor in 1558 and was 4 times master of the city's most important livery company, the Mercers.
This wonderful cup is the most treasured possession of the ancient and honourable Mercers Company. It's also one of their most valuable objects, worth a small fortune. Lee gave this cup to the Mercers Company just a few years after he'd bought the Stoneleigh Abbey estate. There's a coat of arms of the merchant adventurers and a coat of arms of the merchant of the staple. This is to do with the wool trade. Wool was the greatest, I suppose, money-making industry in Britain at this time. That's how he made his fortune. And here, his name's emblazoned upon the cup. Every year at the feast to celebrate the election of the new master of the Mercers Company, the cup is used, is filled with champagne, and a toast is offered. And in that gesture, of course, Thomas Lee has achieved his aims. He has achieved immortality.
The arrival of the new lord of the manor spelt the end of Stoneleigh's rough and ready medieval existence. Lee had no intention of living like his Cistercian predecessors, and he exchanged the austerity of their monastic buildings for a home designed to a new standard of comfort.
The Abbey Church stood here over there. At the east end was a chancel and high altar. Here was the nave. The church was in ruins when Lee acquired the Abbey site, and what survived he soon swept away, with the exception of the south aisle, which still survives. And the aisle survives because Lee made it into the north entrance hall of his new house. The house Thomas Lee created for himself is pleasant, but I think one has to admit, not exceptional. More exciting and more dramatic was the transformation taking place at roughly the same time down the road in Stoneleigh village. There, the rebuilding and alteration of medieval cottages was part of a nationwide revolution that was to lead to the making of the modern home.
In medieval Stoneleigh, just keeping a roof over your head was a challenge. But from the second half of the 16th century, Cottages built for shelter and survival were radically redesigned into the homes we all live in today. The addition of windows, the building of chimneys, and the creation of separate rooms for separate uses totally transformed Stoneleigh's and the nation's cottages. In 1577, William Harrison produced his Description of England. Here it is. It offers a wonderful sort of survey of life at the time, and also contains a very telling description of the late Tudor building boom. He says, for example, here, "For every man almost is a builder, and he that hath bought any small parcel of ground, be it never so little, will not be quiet till he has pulled down the old house and set up anew after his own device." The most striking development of all was the nation's skyline. Harrison wrote that there were old men yet living in his village who in their lifetimes had seen, as Harrison writes it, the multitude of chimneys lately erected, whereas in their young days, they're not above two or three. So rather like the satellite dishes of today or CCTV cameras, in the 1570s, the chimney was the emblem of the modern home. As the country enjoyed a period of relative peace and rising prosperity, even those of modest means had the money to spend on the most dramatic home improvements in the nation's history. This house on the edge of the parish of Stoneleigh was one of those that was completely rebuilt. 460 years ago, Thomas Tudor, a farmer, and his family lived in a medieval cottage on this site. Their 21st century successors are Mary, a company secretary, and her partner, Johnny, an engineer. This is the main living room now of the house, and very comfortable it is. Then what can say about the date as it looks, I suppose, 17th century? But was a house on site before the late 17th century?
Indeed, we can follow it through from 1555. It belonged then to the Blacksmiths Guild of Coventry. And in fact, here's a copy of the lease.
Oh, yes.
Leased it to somebody called Thomas Tudor in the parish of Stoneleigh, but it had a very unusual condition on it. He had to make and set up within the said house a chimney of timber and stone, and also to make a chamber floor over a parlour. Now, what we're seeing here is the characteristic modernisation of houses.
In their basic medieval house, the 10 members of the Tudor family had just three rooms, a bedroom, a kitchen, and a multi-purpose hall. It wasn't until the 17th century, when the house was completely rebuilt, that an upper story allowed for more living space and the luxury of separate bedrooms. Instead of an open hearth, the new house had a chimney stack. In the old medieval house, probably only the hall was heated, but now each room could have its own fireplace. At the end of the 17th century, the property was rented to Richard Camel, whose inventory from 1694 reveals how dramatically life in the house had changed in a century and a half.
And this is the chamber over the kitchen. Mm-hmm. And we've got in the inventory here two bedsteads and two feather beds and bolsters. Mm-hmm. And those would have been for the two children, Mary and Holloway, the daughter and the son of Richard and Elizabeth Camel. And so they were living in here. Across the other side of the stair, we've got Richard and his wife's own bedchamber, which is really quite smart.
This inventory reveals a new level of comfort, doesn't it? With separate, discreet rooms, comfortable, heated with their own fireplaces and private. House of 100 years earlier, three basic rooms, single story, double height, full of smoke, with 10 people crowded into them. That's like going to the moon, isn't it? It's a different world.
It is the contrast between medieval living at the end of the medieval period in the 1550s and what we really recognise as modern living by the time you get to Richard Camel in 1694. This is the modern home.
Step by step, medieval cottages were adapted to meet new standards of domestic comfort. In the modern cottage, glass windows replaced what had been no more than holes in the wall. From the mid-16th century, domestic production of glass expanded to meet rising demand. And by the 1630s, English glassmakers were making around 1 million square feet of glass a year.
You want to come round here, Dan, start to blow it out?
Just a small blow, is it?
In short puffs, is it? Carry on, just keep blowing, I'll stop. Steady. Hold it, Dan.
Too much?
I'll do it again, and the final blow, and it should be all...
OK.
Should be all right.
I'll leave the final blow to you, then. I didn't mess it up, did I?
No, anymore.
So what is the temperature in this? It looks miniature sun.
Probably around about 1,200, 1,250, something like that.
I mean, how traditional is this process? I guess this is how glass was made in the 16th century or 400 or 500 years ago.
This is the same technique. All these skills are getting lost now. We are the last people.
You are the last?
We are the last.
Therefore, you're
We're
one
the only lot. Firm in the country. OK, Dan?
OK, this is, like, obviously, make or break moment.
Yes.
I guess
okay.
I can mess it all up now.
Yes.
I go clockwise.
All right, a bit faster. What? Yes. Now, you can see it's opening up, it's coming out.
So what am I trying to do exactly? We are trying to do... No, women, I won't.
I'm going to lose spin. Spin on. That's it.
Is that right? I'm trying to keep it... obviously, this bar horizontal right. and spin it...
That's all right. Slow it down, but keep turning. Yes.
What am I doing wrong?
Nothing.
Oh, good. Really? I must have done
wrong. Ready to go in the oven.
Hey, you mean it's done? OK. OK. Didn't mess it up. I can't believe it.
Glazed windows had long graced the homes of royalty and aristocracy. But it wasn't until the end of the 16th century that glass became affordable for ordinary mortals.
Ah. Now, you call this bullion glass, don't
yes.
you?
Yes. Years ago, they would be huge bullions, you know, yeah. 5-6 foot in diameter.
So I wonder how many panes of glass would you get from a disc like this?
Maybe 4 or 5.
Four or five.
Yeah. So you just score it first. And then you can start just tapping it.
On the score, on the mark.
And hopefully...
It breaks
along the mark.
Rather than somewhere else. How do you break it off?
And then just snap it off.
It's process... Oh, right. Broken beautifully, very sharp, very crisp. I'd love to have a go at cutting this.
Sure,
make it look so easy, but I see the element of jeopardy. I'm bound to, you know, charmingly make a mess of it. Nothing's as easy as it looks.
Ooh, that's it.
That's the sound. That's the sound, isn't it? Let me get my specs on. I can't actually see the score line. It's, oh, there it is. Oh, my God, that doesn't sound good.
It's starting to veer off a bit, I think.
Is it?
Yes.
I'm in trouble. In trouble. Oh, yeah. Oh.
Oh, well, it righted itself
Sort of. Yeah, yeah. Let's I'll cover it up.
OK.
Not complete disgrace and disaster, almost. Oh, OK.
I'm in that one.
That's how it should be done. Now, this is the perfect piece of glass for a Tudor window. It's beautiful, this one, isn't it? Because you've got the concentric spin mark,
yes.
which makes it very lively.
You can spot a house that's got proper windows in. They'll have a bit of a ripple to them, a bit of life in them.
And, of course, even the most distorted bit of the disc, the bullseye in the middle, which is thick and rather troubling, I suppose, in a sense, because it's so distorted, but even that would be used, wouldn't it?
That would be the cheaper part of the glass, so if you couldn't afford the nice, thin, flat pieces of glass, they would have the piece, the roundel bit in the middle, for their windows. But, of course, now it's the complete reverse, where we do bullions for the centrepiece. These are feature windows now.
The antique-y look.
Yes, absolutely. Yes.
By the start of the 17th century, glazed windows began to be spotted around Stoneleigh. They were reserved for the most important rooms and were often only added to the front of a house, where they would be sure to catch the eye of envious neighbours.
Thomas Hill lived at what is now 11 and 12 Coventry Road, Stoneleigh. He was a yeoman farmer, a man of some means, and, we know, the proud possessor of two glass windows. The windows are mentioned in the inventory of his household goods attached to his will of 1631, along with other high-value items of luxury, such as beds and tables and chairs. The windows are mentioned as movables. That is, when you left your home, you took your windows with you.
By the end of the 17th century, the cottage, which had started life as the most basic of homes, had proved the most adaptable of architectural templates. Within the same simple structure, new rooms were created for new uses, and new improvements, like glass windows and chimneys, added. This revolution produced a whole new home. Although Stoneleigh's cottages had experienced a remarkable transformation into modern homes, much of village life remained virtually medieval. In the 19th century, as the Industrial Revolution changed Britain beyond all recognition, the Lee family carried on regardless and kept running their village along feudal lines. From the almshouses to the village school, the family founded and financed every institution that saw their tenants through from cradle to grave. In 1850, William Henry Lee became the new lord of the manor. He asserted the same hold over his tenants' lives as the monks of Stoneleigh Abbey had done 500 years earlier. William Lee had a great concern for the lives and the welfare of his tenants. That concern is recorded in his extraordinary collection of notebooks belonging to him. From 1853, for over 40 years, he conducted an annual estate survey, going from cottage to cottage, recording the condition of the building and also notes about the lives of the tenants inside those cottages. Now, here we go. Let's have a look. 1895, 96 here. Charles Allingham, three bedrooms. He's paying £4.10 per annum. Good cottage, but painting required, chimney mending, and a step missing. Incredible, meticulous, tiny detail about the fabric of the Stoneleigh cottages. This one here. Here we go, Mr. Mills. His cottage has three bedrooms. Eight children at home, he notes. Good cottage, though. But plastering required in a bedroom. But do I detect some sort of dismay or disturbance about the eight children at home? Perhaps he's worried that the cottage is overcrowded or the children are too old to be living at home. I suppose, you know, William Lee's a good landlord and concerned about his tenants, but one senses some element of moral policing going on here. In their vast Georgian pile, at the heart of the largest estate in Warwickshire, the Lees' position seemed unassailable. But behind the scenes, income from the estate had scarcely risen in a century. And as debts mounted, Lord Lee flatly refused to confront the problem. Throughout the countryside, the old model of cottages owned by a landlord and occupied by his dutiful tenants no longer seemed sustainable. But as Britain's population shifted decisively from predominantly rural to overwhelmingly urban, the cottage was reinvented for a new age. Amidst the grit and grime of the Victorian city, the nostalgic appeal of the quaint country cottage proved irresistible. Picturesque views of idyllic cottages captured the popular imagination, and even Stoneleigh's homes graced a Victorian postcard. In Britain's expanding cities, this infatuation would fuel a new building boom. Beginning at the end of the 19th century and gathering pace in the 20th century, a mania for mock Tudor took the new suburbs by storm.
Let's go for a nice walk.
Walk? What, in these London streets? Petrol, oil fumes?
Oh, my dear, don't
get ready. I'm so sorry, darling. Honestly, I don't mean it, but I'm tired of these surroundings. We're cooped up in this London flat all the days of our lives.
Well, then, let's go out into the country.
The country? Where?
There's awfully nice houses at Pearly Oaks. Charming.
Pearly Oaks.
And they went. Moving swiftly along the wide avenues, we noticed particularly how well situated are these homes.
The semi was just the latest evolution of the cottage, offering the rustic pleasures of the countryside with all mod cons.
They are pulling up at one of the furnished show houses.
From early arts and crafts models to modern Barrett homes, semis were so successful that around 20 million of us now live in one.
This is the tiled bathroom, replete with all that goes to make the daily ablutions pleasurable. There are three bedrooms on the first floor, and they all overlook the rolling countryside.
Suburban semis, most of which were owned, not rented, weren't just an escape from overcrowded towns and cities, but from overbearing landlords. Yet in Stoneleigh, the Leighs continued to treat the village as their private fiefdom.
The Leighs were generous to their tenants, but surely willingly did Stoneleigh a disservice when he closed the local pub. The reason for this bizarre action is that he was outraged when a bunch of visiting cyclists sitting outside the pub drinking whistled at his daughter in a lascivious manner. So he closed the pub and refused to have any other pubs in the village. The locals, who rather liked to gather for a convivial pint, were slightly puzzled what to do. So the solution was a good one. They started a village club, which is really little more than a private drinking establishment. It flourishes still to this day and is really the heart and soul of the village. We're in what is now the village club. What role did it used to play in the life of the village?
It was a men-only club, actually.
Was it?
Oh, well, yes. And they used to collect the rent here.
Oh, really?
At a trestle table, yes. And Lord Lee's agent would be there collecting. People used to come in and just pay.
That's very merciful. You'd pay your rent in the club, so you'd have a pint of Guinness, perhaps.
Well, did it? Yeah. I mean, it was probably morning when they did it, but
we start drinking early here. Yeah.
And they'd pay their money over. Mostly, well, cash, of course, because people dealt in cash then. My father, he didn't have a bank account, used to keep his money in a tin, in a box of sand with the carrots over winter. This is the receipt that my father had for the cottage.
So here you are, £8.19 for half a year's rent for this cottage. And the address is below it, number 12
Coventry Road. Yes.
I suppose at this point, most of Stoneleigh was occupied by tenants of the Leigh family.
Yes.
Well, how did people then regard him?
He was a gentleman. He was just a very good lord.
Yeah. And landlord, presumably.
Landlord, of course.
Presumably, the tenants felt secure and the rents were fairly fixed, stable.
Yes. And my father was the old school, and I can remember that he doffed his cap to him, saying, "Good morning, Your Lordship," you know, and I stood back a little bit. I thought, ooh, to me that was rather strange, but obviously he was still living in the old times when you honoured the Lord Leigh.
The devotion of his tenants could do little to ease the financial woes Rupert Leigh had inherited from his father and his grandfather. In 1946, he resorted to desperate measures to bring in some extra cash.
Good afternoon, Lord Leigh.
Good afternoon.
Tell me one thing. Do you ever feel like something out of the zoo with all these people wandering around your lovely house? Because I imagine that if they get a glimpse of you, it rather makes their day for them, doesn't it?
Well, I don't know about that.
The Abbey was one of the first stately homes in the country to open its doors to the public.
Is there anything in particular that the public usually wants to see in the house?
Oh, yes, there is a beautiful double chair, which is known as the sweetheart chair or courting chair, in the silk drawing room.
What's interested you most in this lovely old house?
Well, that big drawing room, you know, with all the red plush furniture and the gilt and the candelabra in the middle, you know.
Yes. Would you like to live in a room like that, then?
Oh, I don't think so, because the dog's ears would show up on the red plush.
For more than four centuries, the Leighs had done very well out of their position as lords of the manor. But the bond between landlord and tenants was finally broken in 1989. Rupert Leigh's son Piers followed the lead of hard-up landowners around the country and put the estate and all the cottages on the market.
The tenants, who'd lived in these cottages for generations, simply couldn't afford to buy them. But there were plenty of newcomers ready to pay serious money for their very own rural idylls.
And the perfectly manicured homes of Stoneleigh's new owner occupiers are proof of our enduring affection for the cottage.
I just thought it was amazing when I walked in. It just had such a lovely feel. The log fire was burning on the day we walked in. It was just what we wanted, really.
It's nice that all the old features of the cottage, like the fireplace, which dates back to a very early stage of the house, gives it a lot of character. I think the history is very important. Yeah. We feel a definite sense of being the custodians of a real piece of history. And it's actually feels like quite a responsibility and an honour to be looking after it for a while.
I love living here. We're both very happy here. It's gorgeous.
Throughout Britain, the cottage has undergone a remarkable reinvention. From the humblest of medieval homes, it has become one of the most sought-after pieces of real estate.
It's more than just nostalgia that's made cottage living into something of a national obsession. These timbers speak of 500 years of redesign and rebuilding. And it's that remarkable history that is the secret to why the cottage is still going strong.
Next time, I'm exploring the terrace, the home designed to take the strain in booming Victorian towns and cities. I'll discover why the terrace became the home of choice for a house-proud nation.
So 10 minutes later, I'll be still be doing this, won't I?
And how his extraordinary staying power has ensured it a new lease of life.
I imagine you hope you'll be here for some years.
Forever.
Forever,
okay. I've come forever, Dan.